Welcome to the STABcast, a podcast dedicated to Star Wars Legion.
Don't.
You must have known you'd see me again.
I was counting on it. Just didn't plan on it being so soon. Of course, now you've got a problem.
Big problem. You happen to notice that freighter down there? You know what's on it? About 30 hired guns. All I gotta do is give them the signal, you're surrounded.
Welcome, cadets and commanders, to the STABcast, the Sunsphere Tactical Attack Brigade's Star Wars Legion podcast. I'm Ryan, just kind of showed up Slawoski, joined by Chad, the nerdy old man Riggs, and Will, the official STABcast photographer Werner. Ben, actually in a fever dream, this time Fowler. Will, pull out game Strongheim, and Tim, making excuses on another podcast, Hannon, are out of action tonight. Well, gentlemen, I appreciate you joining me. How are we doing this evening?
Very well, doing good.
Yeah, good. I'm excited to be here. This is fun.
Yeah, so for a little bit of backstory, you guys have been mentioned on the show God knows how many times at this point, but you guys are kind of the two big pillars of our local play community that the actual STABcast is not.
Well, we do our best.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, that's where STABcast started, so it's nice to have you guys kind of carrying that torch and spirit and finally able to come on the show.
Well, we're here to try to help. This week on the STABcast, we're going to do some battle reports, Rocky Top Game Con prep. Will and I are going to try to figure out why in the world we're even here, and this isn't my regular podcast.
This is not your regular podcast. So yeah, I talked a little bit already about why you guys are here, and you have another podcast, so you want to go ahead and plug that, Chad, right at the top of the show?
Yeah, thank you so much. The Nerdy Old Men Podcast. We talk about everything nerd, geeky, and pop culture-like. We don't touch on Legion a whole much, because that's Ryan and his guy's gang, but we've had Ryan on our show before.
There'd be a turf war.
That's right, and there's only two of us. So, but me and my old buddy Redneck Wes, and we get together, have a good time. You can find us anywhere that you can find this podcast here. You can find ours, Facebook and Instagram, or our key social media. So we would really appreciate it if you give us a yell and just give us a listen, see what you think.
Yeah, you guys definitely should. It's a little bit different beat than us here at STABcast, but they do a good job of bringing a unique perspective to a lot of different kind of like nerd and geek culture aspects, which is cool. Will's just kind of here. We invited him along now.
Yeah, it's
Will
true.
Was Will you've really stepped up, and even like at the local level, you know, been running or setting up a lot of our tournaments going into store championship season. You were I was the face of our local league, but you were definitely the backbone.
Yeah, I mean, it's I would consider you guys to be kind of the floor, and it is a nice foundation that we've been able to kind of build and grow this community on. So if it weren't for you guys, we wouldn't be able to. So it's great.
Yeah, and me and you had a fun weekend last weekend, where we went down to
Nashville.
We've been trying to get that community off the ground for I don't know how long. It was a cool scene there pre-pandemic, but after the pandemic, it never really got off the ground. And so me and Will went out there without seats, just to kind of like hang out and help out, because they only had 12 spaces. And like, if people didn't show up, then we were ready to play. And Will got to play, and I got to judge. So it was a really cool time to watch Will, much like our local Will here, disappoint me.
Yes, well, you know, it's too much pressure. Is what it is. And I had the pleasure of running into my first double dark double IRG list, and that was just, I'll tell you.
Yeah, it's a thing that happens to you sometimes.
Long live the Empire.
Yeah, so. Like, on its head, on its face, that list is not unbeatable. And I guess this is, I don't know, this is a tangent, but an interesting conversation. Double Dark, especially when you throw the Guardian nonsense in there, it's not an unbeatable list. I don't even think it's necessarily I would say it's unbalanced, but it's, you can beat it, but you have to skew so far to beat it that you're going to lose to a lot of other things that you probably shouldn't lose to.
Right.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. It does. And, you know, I try not to second guess moves and games and things. Mm-hmm. I feel like, so really, it was the palp bomb in that kind of sealed it, because it was single heavy on both of the dark troopers. And so they're right. So they're throwing what, five black, six black.
Yeah, depending on which heavy. Yeah.
Yeah, which, you know, isn't quite as bad as the consistent sure. eight. You know, maybe two reds and a black in there. So yeah. Maybe if
with
I could have
blast. Yeah,
maybe if I could have rushed that palp bomb, because he just dove in and just wiped out my entire core with that palp bomb. So it's tough, but not unbeatable for sure.
Yeah, and your list, I think, had a decent, of all the lists at that event, I think you had one of the best chances against it with your impact ranged Pierce.
Yes.
Talk a little about your list, yeah.
Yeah, so that one, I don't have it pulled up here. It is, it's Boba with C's and the flamethrower. It is a bus, shrift bus. I believe
yeah,
it is that one.
I do love shrimp buses.
Here, I should probably stop guessing and just pull it up once.
Well, I mean, we don't need all the upgrades. Yeah. Just kind of, what was the gist of your list?
Will is much like Nathan and has about 10,000 lists saved.
It's true.
That's true, yeah.
So Nathan and we bounce lists back and forth so much. It's insane. All right, so the Boba Wookiee bus line. So it's Boba, Chewie for Protector.
Sure.
Two Rebel Beds, two Mark IIs, two Shooty Wookiees with the Bowcaster, and then the Shriv bus, yeah.
Okay.
And it's okay. The Wookiees are naked except for the bowcaster, and they really need the T-scopes, I feel like. And the O-push, if you can get it to them.
Yeah, I think O-push over scopes. I don't know. We all know I don't believe in things, so y'all have seen my dice.
That's your problem. That's your problem. But this was really a retooling of the full commandos list that I took to Cherokee that I really loved. And this one is just, it's not as good. it's still fun, and I beat the other well with it. It is not as good. So, yeah.
This is STABcast. We tend to do bat reps. Do you guys have some games you wanna talk about that you've gotten to play the last little while?
Yeah, I mean, Will, if you want to talk about how you beat me the other day, which mind you, I and Ryan can attest, I love the list that I'm playing. I mean, I love
yeah,
it, and
yeah.
it has done very well for me, except for probably when I go to Rocky Top and I'll get rocked with it. But up until now, I've done really well with it. I won down that little thing down in Cleveland and stuff like that. But mm-hmm. But I've gotten beat a couple times with it, and Will was one of the guys that did it, and I know what I did wrong. But Will, if you want to tell the folks how you embarrassed me.
Well, the first step is to beat your head against it for two or three other games until you get tired of losing to it. And so this one, it was a 212th list. We just got Cody in the Republic.
Sure.
And I don't think there's anything more beautiful than trying to make like cinematic moments happen, you know. So trying to get Kenobi and Cody in a list was the intent here.
Well said, as our photographer, by the way.
Thank you.
He's good at that. Yeah.
So we got Kenobi barrier push to nasty. We got Cody with T scopes. Those T scopes coming back. We got phase twos with the mortar and medics, and then we've got two phase ones with the RPS. And then two bark speeders with RPS and comms relay.
All the impact.
All of the impact. And it's, was it enough impact, Chad? What do you think?
Well, that played a key role. It did.
Yeah.
And the fact that every time I play Will, let's say about two of every three matches, I play way too defensively. And that's when he rocked me this time. Is that not right, Will? I mean that played a big role to it. I just did not push up.
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
Because I had an 800 point list: Imperial Remnant, seven activations, Moff Gideon, the Darksaber, one Shore Trooper with the DLT-19 sniper, with recon intel, had one Stormy with a sniper, had full scouts with the T-21 Stormtrooper. Imperial Death Troopers, one of those, with an HH-12 recon intel and the E-11 Delta. And then I had two Dark Troopers, one of them with programmed loyalty, and both of them had the assault cannon as well as a frag launcher. So that was 800, and it seemed like a lot, and it seemed like it was going to go pretty good.
It is. It is a lot. I just played it. It is a lot.
It's like I pushed up my darks and forgot to push everybody else up. So that's kind of how that went. But Will can describe how he did that.
Yeah, I was about to say, when we play Chad, I feel like you never leave your deployment zone.
Yeah.
And I didn't this time, and that was a problem.
So I think kind of what happened in that one is, do you remember what the setup was for that one, Chad?
Yeah, it was advanced positions, war weary.
Intercept, right.
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So Ryan, I recently sat down and looked at, because I've only been playing about a year now.
Right.
And I sat down and I looked at some of these objectives, and I looked at Intercept, actually, was one of them.
Mm-hmm.
And I did the math, and
it's a pretty cool objective.
I realized that for Intercept, I don't need to rush the center. As long as I can secure the center for the last activation, or for the last round, and get the double points there, then it can go to kill points, right?
See, that's funny, as I'm not saying you're wrong. But we all know I'm a very aggressive player. And so I'm always going to take the center on the first turn and then back off and just try to nullify it at the end.
Interesting.
So I play that completely the other way.
Yeah, because for me, I think it's going to be, with my range 4 impact list, it's going to be easier to whittle them down and then rush in at the end, right?
And that's fair. You've got range 4 and lots of impact. I've got T-shirt Save Rebels.
Yeah, exactly, right? So, but that was kind of the game plan. Chad, even though it was advanced positions, you deployed really conservatively with everything except for your Dark Troopers.
Which was probably the beginning of the end of that. Because, well, the thing is I normally with that list will focus fire and try to eliminate activations, and it ends up working in my favor. But for some reason this time, that advanced position deployment, only being able to be out just a little bit, even with my recon intel, I just held back. And I, for the life of me, I can't figure it out. It's some kind of voodoo magic that Will put on me. I'm not real sure what it was, but it was something. He got me.
Teach me this.
Well, no,
magic.
that and all that impact. I mean, that's how you deal with those, because I mean, you correct me if I'm wrong on that, Will, but, you know, I mean, most people, Dark Troopers, I think, at least from my experience, are pretty easy to play because there's just not a lot of decision in it. You know, I mean, there's no cover. You know, who cares? Who gives a crap about cover?
Just
run them down their throat, you know, and teleport, you know, and that's that. So what do you do? Well, you can't ignore them. So you got to do something with them. And he had the impact to be able to do something with them. And that just worked out. He just focused it right in.
Yeah, one of those big keys was Cody, actually.
Yeah.
With that surge to crit, the T-scopes, mm-hmm. you fire support that RPS in there, like that hits hard. I think I got, seven crits with a lethal through on one of those shots.
Yes,
That's good.
It was pretty spicy.
You know, and normally bringing my Dark Troopers, or I'm sorry, the Death Troopers up with that HH-12 is just sneak. I mean, that is a great unit. And
it's
stupid, and people and I think people, a lot of people don't pay it. I mean, now I'm letting out, I'm sure people realize that, but I mean, it can be very devastating. And I just kind of hung them there, just hanging out, covering the center thing, which was stupid. But you know, I think in that entire game, I mean, he played masterfully and just wore me out, and we ended up going to kill points. But I think the only thing that was positive is I used the you have something I want, and I was able to put a full unit of darks right near Obi, and just about got him, right, Will? But he just saved enough and ran off, and that was going to be my sentimental victory in that one.
Yeah, and I feel like that one was it was really because I know how you like to play your Dark Troopers, because there's two ways to play that 2-pip, right? There's to preserve your activations by running away with an objective or away with the kill points, right? So you can't kill the Dark Trooper.
Mm-hmm.
But the way Chad likes to play it is he likes to use it to flank you.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And so the only spot in a good flanking position that I left Chad was right next to my Jedi and all of my impact. So that's kind of right where he went. Don't know that I would have been able to leave that open had I not been playing Chad and known that that's how he likes to use them, you know?
Sure.
So I couldn't count on that again, but it was effective.
Yeah, I know at Dice Head when me and Chad played, I tried to do the same thing, but there was just enough room in the corner where I kind of put my FD cannon for him to squeeze four models, and it took us a minute to find if there was enough real estate for them to fit, and then they did, and it was my undoing.
Yeah,
it's tough.
I mean, that's another way to use them, which I think is really awesome to be able to, mm-hmm. I mean, that's just really the key to that card, right? But it definitely can, you know, one way to counteract that is like something that Nathan did, which was spread his army out everywhere. And I literally could not. I had nowhere to go.
Droids,
and with droids, you could do it because he had a ton of them. I mean, there's like 10,000 freaking B1s running around, you know? And I couldn't have, I pretty much like bunny hopped a little bit forward, you know? it's like a speed three move instead of going all the way across the board. I can't, you know, just to a different spot. But yeah, I mean, it's and I guess that's a thing where like me and Will have played each other a ton, and we start kind of figuring that stuff out.
Yeah, it definitely, it's a factor. It helps.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. But I played, we played what, Friday, Will?
Yeah.
I played on Wednesday night against Alan. It's the first time I'd played Alan. Alan's one of our new guys, and he's very enthusiastic, and he's a really cool dude.
Alan's
he's
the best.
He's a really cool dude.
Yeah, he's great,
man. And kind of what I wanted to talk about is you know, I won that match pretty decisively because he's new.
Say.
Well, I'm prepping to get my ass kicked at another big tournament. So
just like
a jerky. I want to come in thinking I'm awesome and then get the crap beat out of me. So, you know, that's just how I roll. But no, I think what's very important about that is the teaching moments that you can give people. And I got those when I first started too. Not mm-hmm. that I'm an expert or anything, but I always learn, but it's important to know your opponent's capabilities too, because if you can, I mean, it can be difficult to try to remember everything, but he pulled, he had a couple barks and I was running the same list and he pulled one bark right after the other, right in range two of my scout troopers. So I've got four scouts and a T-21. So that's eight black, four white. Yeah,
that hurts.
You know,
that hurts.
I mean, it was just, and then there was dark troopers playing linebacker for him. And I was like, you know, driving that straight down the throat, maybe not be the best idea. Talking to him with the whole purpose of, I want you to get better because you're going to make me better. Because we have more competitive games that way. And that's something that I learned from that is, if this happened to me, what would I want to do? So I sat down mm-hmm. with him, and we went kind of through the whole game talking about, okay, well, this and this, and you need to be a little bit more aggressive with these. And I hope that's worked out for him. I dig that kind of thing, and I think that's a good thing about the community as a whole, or at least most of us anyway, everybody I've run into, has been very helpful with that.
Yeah, and I will give Alan a lot of credit. He came into this game, and he's like, I'm going to play Double Jedi in Republic.
Yeah.
One of the most technical, like, zero room for errors and mistakes lists you can put out there, Obi-Wan and Anakin together. And he's like, I'm going to get my teeth kicked in. And he just keeps showing up every Wednesday a little bit better, a little bit stronger, making a little bit better decisions. And because that is a... I'm not brave enough to run that list, and I've played a lot of Luke.
And he's getting a lot better at it, and he's sticking with this thing, and he's plowing uh-huh. through it. There were segments of that game where I was like, ah, crap. He's thrown a monkey wrench into what I wanted to do, you know, and that's ideal and perfect. What I learned from that match, too, is the way I want to play is, you know, obviously if it's against a new person when the game's over, teaching them and you know, and say, hey, this is something that didn't work out for you, this one did, is like on this one, I was like, I really want to kill Obi-Wan. And I ran Moff Gideon over there and got him killed. Whereas in a tournament situation, I'm like, no, I'm going to hide behind this freaking building like a coward because I'm in range of my mm-hmm. objective. But
and no matter how many times you run him over with swoops, he just keeps throwing saves.
He did. That and those scout troopers too gave you a little bit of a.
Oh, I was so mad.
They're white saves. He just couldn't kill them. They just wouldn't die.
I was so mad.
But you know, that's something we've noticed about our community. I'm sure everybody else out there in the different parts of the country and the world that listen to the show, they have that same kind of thing, or at least I hope they do. And that's something that I noticed when I first came into is I've had, you know, I had different folks come to me and talk to me about my list and Ryan, you did it and other guys did it too, and say, hey, you know, I know you want to play this, but that doesn't work really well right now because, you know, like I think Gav tanks look cool. But
yep, they are cool.
But you know, some other things work a little bit better. So yeah, that's kind of how.
Well, and everybody's bringing impact anyway to deal with darks. Yeah. Like anything that's not a dark trooper just can't repel that kind of impact. So
it's a fact. It's a fact.
But no, me and you and Chad, we kind of share that. We tend to mess around a little bit, and then once we've decided to sink our teeth into a list, we'll play it for 2-3 months pretty consistently. As opposed to like Will was talking about earlier, that, you know, him and Nathan tend to list hop around.
Yes, yes.
I mean, you and Nathan both do, but I feel like there are like 2 or 3 core ideas that you guys kind of like oscillate between.
Yeah.
And the trimmings around those ideas change.
Yeah, I think.
But you've been playing Boba Wookiees.
Yes, I love Boba Wookiees. Boba anything really at this point. he's just so good. He's not as good as Empire Boba, but he's very good. And I think kind of what that comes down to is like trying. I like to list hop because I like to try things that people don't think are good, you know, see what you can do with that. But you kind of end up coming to a lot of the same conclusions. And that's why you see me ending up back in these same archetypes, right?
So,
The exploration is kind of, it's fun. So,
yeah, yeah. So I'm in for my game this week. I've played a couple games at Sci-Fi the past 2 weeks, but I think the most interesting game is I'm playing on TTS, which I don't play a ton of, but I'm in the Yavin based team league with my Aussie brethren playing on the Australian team.
Oh, fancy.
Yeah, I know. And they needed a fifth, and they're like, Ryan's insane. He'll stay up at our hours.
He's basically Australian.
He's pretty much Australian. And our first game of the new season, it was against the team that knocked us out last year.
Oh,
so
that's rough.
So yeah,
vengeance.
Yeah, that's the fun thing about Yavin Base is the storylines. You get the WWE storylines. naturally, as someone who always consistently plays the same list over and over and over again, I played something I have one practice game with.
Perfect.
Yes. So
it sounds like me at Cherokee. Yeah, come in, never played it before. Good, best idea ever.
So the way Yavin Base works is one of the list building tricks is they pick a unit for each faction that's banned for that round to kind of increase variety. And it affected, I am sure, next to nobody, but for our season opener, Tauntauns were banned.
Oh, of course.
So I had to do a hard pivot. I wanted to run my 12 activation Cassian list, but my teammates were like, no, we're not going to let you play Rebel Swoops. So I ended up taking a Sabine Ahsoka list. I've watched Mitch has been playing Ahsoka, proxying her lately at the store, and we had a really fun game. He made Ahsoka look super fun. So I wanted to give it a go. He plays it with Din, but I wanted to play that teamwork card.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, yeah. Just a quick aside.
Quick asides is what we do here.
I did the Pink Suns. I played Pink Suns for him so he could get some practice against the Black Suns. And
gotcha. He
plastered me with Ahsoka and Din. Grogu. The hand thing, and I shot at Din with his 2 dodges. Suddenly he had 5 dodges. And Guardian 2, I was like, what just happened?
Sounds nasty.
And then he evaporated me. I was like, holy cow.
Yeah.
It was impressive.
Yeah, he's got enough Pierce in that list to deal with Black Sun, I think, reasonably well.
Yeah, it was spicy.
Black Sun likes to be close, but not melee, typically.
Yeah.
That's cool. But he sparked that in me that I wanted to play it, and I wanted to not take the Darksaber, because I feel like the Darksaber's a crutch for Sabine, and in my 2 practice games, I've learned you have to take the Darksaber.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's a hot take.
I mean, I did play Tauntauns for a year because I thought they were bad, and I just had to convince myself that they weren't, so this is how I play Legion. I'm broken inside. But I got 1 practice game with friend of the show Brett beforehand, and I got to battle lines, and I'm like, you know, with this list, I just need to avoid battle lines. And it's a generic officer, Sabine, Ahsoka, 3 vets with CMOs, 1 Mark II, and 2 FD cannons.
Okay, interesting.
So yeah, it's only 9 acts, but you know, I wanted the vet gun line, and I did like the 3 CMOs and 3 Mark IIs, but I had a bunch of points left over, so I'm just like, let me soup a couple of these. I couldn't really get a worthwhile activation without adding another token type, so I was like, let me just substitute in some big activations, and I knew there was a chance I was gonna need impact if I got a Dark Trooper matchup. And I felt double FD was a good enough way to do that, so I didn't have to commit Ahsoka to solo whatever impact right. was there. So me and Eternal play off of Team Relentless, and we are the first game to get scheduled out of our set. So Yavin Base is teams of five, and everybody plays one game, and it's the best of five. The team gets the win. We're the first ones out of the gate, and we end up on battle lines, the thing I decided I didn't need, but of course. It was there. Intercept the transmissions and War Weary. We went to intercept, and I didn't push from battle lines to major, because otherwise I'm playing Hostage. And while Hostage is in my deck, my list theoretically is pretty good at Hostage, with a force push from Ahsoka and Sabine with Whipcord to immobilize, and I got all kinds of nasty little tricks I can do to kind of slow them down. I, as a player, Ryan, not necessarily my army, am terrible at Hostage. I probably have a 15% win rate on Hostage.
I've been playing for about a year, and I have never won a game of Hostage, so I get that.
Yep. I understand that, too.
It's tough.
So I pushed to intercept and said, you know what? Bad deployment, be damned. It's FDs don't hate battle lines. I'll be fine. And when you're playing new, especially like unreleased content, you know, proxying stuff in, I got my command card timing all kinds of wrong. All kinds of wrong. And it just put me, like, tempo-wise, a turn behind. I got some great shots turn one using my range 4 crit guns. Eternal poked a little too far forward with some battle droids. My FDs were lighting stuff up. I got quite a few more wounds out of the first turn than he did. And we basically, on intercept, we balled our entire armies up around one of the flanking points. He put General Grievous. I guess I should talk about Eternal's list. He played General Grievous and Kalani.
I haven't seen Grievous in forever.
That's fun.
With Magna Droids, two B2s with Haas and T-Series, and then B1s as far as the eye can see.
Okay.
We both balled almost everything up in one corner where there was quite a bit of cover. There was some elevation changey stuff, some cool places to hide. I committed one set of both my sets of vets and my Mark II to the middle, and he puts just Grievous to threaten the middle. So it was a knockdown drag out. My Mark II immediately just starts running for the far point that we both abandon, knowing that if I can just get there, camp, and sit, it's the best 38 points I've ever spent. We set up for the middle. I order my two operatives to where I can make sure that they go late, but I do it with the wrong command card. I should have done it with the teamwork card to scoot them into a little bit better position towards the end, knowing that there would be very minimal risk because they would only get one or two kind of big shots, but they would have dodges and cool tricks. And I kind of messed that up. So when Ahsoka went for the burst of speed dive, she was kind of in the wrong spot. Sabine gets where she needs to go to deliver one of the greatest explosions cards I've ever played. Ahsoka dives into some B1s, and I pulled a clever trick where I moved Ahsoka into base to base with a large piece of terrain and snapped the B1s around me. So the Magna Guards that were right next to me had no surface area.
Okay.
So they couldn't get in and beat her to death.
That's pretty slick.
I still managed to take some wounds on the approach because of my sloppy position on turn two. And so turn three, I throw explosions. I'm hoping just to keep using B1s to bubble wrap myself away from the Magna Guards. Sabine's plan is to whipcord the Magnas so they can't charge Ahsoka and do her explosions, toss, and free move. And I hit, I think, seven different units with both of my bombs.
Oh, wow.
That's impressive.
Yeah, but sadly, one of them was Ahsoka.
Oh.
The first bomb deals no damage to Ahsoka, and I think I get probably seven wounds off the table from B2s. Like, there were some crits and some surges. I get a wound on some Magnas. I kill a bunch of B1s. Like, it was an amazing explosion. Plus, we're playing War Weary. I did two damage to Kalani. Like, suppression's going everywhere.
Yeah, nice.
I throw the second one. Ahsoka with two wounds remaining and a surge token. The bomb rolls two hits onto Ahsoka, and she rolls double blanks. Ouch.
Yikes.
I've only played one of her cards.
Well, that narrows your choices down a little bit.
Yeah, just a touch. Yeah. So I then have to start playing really aggressive with Sabine and some of my other troopers. Grievous is just face rolling into my vets and my Mark II. My Mark II, before he dies, gets Grievous down to one wound. In order to make that charge, Grievous has four suppression and has to make a killer rally. Otherwise, he can't kill my or charge and get my Mark II. He clears it like a boss, charges me and kills me, and I give up the game. It was a super fun game. My lack of practice was my undoing, and I my dice were not terrible. They were just great in the wrong places. Sabine's saves were pretty solid. Ahsoka's were not. My rebel officer was rolled 3 for 4 twice.
Nice. Oof.
Jeez. As he cowardly ran away. So it was like I had good dice. They just weren't where I needed them.
I've heard you guys talk on the show, practice your lists. I 100%. That's why I like to stick to one thing for a while. And you're absolutely right. Because you know, like I go back to my epic fail that was Cherokee this year. And I thought I'd been playing a list, and I lost a couple times before the event. And I'm like, you know what? I'm gonna do something entirely different. And I did, and it was awful.
Yeah.
And my first practice game with it was the first game of Cherokee. So So I learned from that. So a little note from this guy who's not that great, but you know, practice what you got, because if not, it's gonna.
Hey, you got a winning record against me. Well, don't sell yourself short. There's like three people who have a winning record against me.
I know you want that. We got to go back and see if we can get a tie.
That's right. That's right.
That's good stuff, though. Good stuff. Will is the official STABcast photographer, and you know, I'm about to move some guys, and here comes Will's hand. Wah! To take some pictures. And he takes some wicked awesome pictures. I love it. I think they're great. You know. And
yeah. So here's my question about that: Is does it take you guys out of the moment?
No.
When I do that,
it doesn't bother me. No, it doesn't bother me. I'm hoping that I've made my decision before I reach down on the table. To anyway,
you would hope so.
Y'all have played games with me, and the store could be on fire. And if I'm
that's
in a
true,
game,
yeah,
I
he wouldn't even know. But Will likes to make some of those cinematic moments, and if you want to see some of those cinematic moments, make sure you go to the STABcast Instagram page at SWSTABcast. That's at SWSTABcast for all of your picture desire needs.
And if you don't like the pictures but you like the words, you can sometimes find us on Facebook, and we have a Twitter. I don't know the last time we used it, but if you want to follow us there, you can do that, I guess, while it burns down. But all of our handles across all of social media are SWSTABcast.
And be sure to check out the Legion Discord and any streaming services that we should mention, Ryan.
Yeah, you can check out Tim sometimes streams at Timitation Irish.
Excellent.
I stream. You can follow us at SWSTABcast. There's somebody else here who might be streaming sometime in the relatively near and or far future.
Not this guy.
Maybe me. For now, though, we have the Tennessee Volunteer Legion Discord as well, and Facebook group, if anyone's interested in that. So.
Yeah, it's a cool collection of all the play groups from across the state of Tennessee.
It's a good
even
one.
Some like in North Georgia and the Western Carolinas.
Yeah, it's a good one. Will needs to stream because I have a face for radio, so that's not not a good thing for me.
Yeah, see, I'll stream and I'll write the scripts, but I need your radio voice. Well,
that we can do. Will. It's all I got.
All right, hear me out. We will just put Will on the desk. And you can just move your mouth, and we'll have Chad with the microphone behind the
there column. We go. Yeah. Perfection. Hey, that's fine with me. That's fine with me. I can. It's all I've got. I'm going to play the cards I've got. You know what I mean? But if you want to hear some more of my voice, check out our podcast, the Nerdy Old Men podcast. Yeah, so, like we said before, shameless plug.
Absolutely. If you want to support this ridiculous endeavor, you can go to teespring.com/store/STABcast to buy T-shirts, fanny packs, sweaters, whatever you might happen to want. We're still working on that STABcast onesie for Alpaz. Our R&D department is going to be closed. Or if you want to drop us a line at swstabcast@gmail.com with whatever you guys want to hear us jibber-jabber about, we'll get to it, I don't know, eventually. Yeah. But 'tis the season. The new organized play season is upon us. And holy do you guys keep emailing us and telling us about all your tournaments.
It's exciting, though.
It's exciting. I'm shocked by how many are just in like the Legion Discord. Those upcoming tournaments, wow.
And those are like bigger tournaments that aren't just like, hey, our local store is holding a store championship. Those are like big convention attached 2 to 3 day tournaments, and they are like multiple a month, which is insane.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, May the 4th was the start of the new organized play season, right?
Yep.
Nice.
Yep.
And almost immediately after that was the Richmond Open.
Yeah, I guess we can take that one off our list. Yeah. The John Brown Richmond Open went on. It seemed like it was a solid event. You know, I know a lot of the guys who run that tournament. It looks like they did an awesome job. I felt bad. They were our rivals last year. They were the same weekend as Rocky Top.
Ooh, that's tough.
So we couldn't say nice things about them. We had to sign the contract. But no, it was super cool that they sold out. That went really well for them. The next weekend, there is a bunch of tournaments. First and foremost, Rocky Top Game Con is Memorial Day weekend, May 27th, 28th. 5 rounds of Swiss. We are currently sold out. We have a wait list. The wait list is starting to move. I know a bunch of people have asked me about it. I've put names on it, and as people email me that they're not able to make it, I'm trying to transfer those tickets to people who can. If you show up with a weekend badge to Rocky Top Game Con and have an army, and I have some no-shows, you might be able to play. So if you're in the Knoxville area and you want to take a stab at that, feel free to show up. Or if you know you have to, you can go to Detroit same weekend to the Motor City Mayhem, or all the way out in San Francisco, the Bay Area Open at Kublai Khan, run by Nima and the crew out there. That tournament's going to be awesome, but not as awesome as Rocky.
No, of course not. So. But you could also go to Iron Weld in Boston. That's May 27th and 28th. Looks like
Tim might be making an appearance there. We'll see.
32 we'll players, 5 rounds of Swiss, 3 on Saturday, 2 on Sunday. And you can get some more information about that at wickeddicey.com, wickeddicey.com. It's just I'll be at Rocky Top, and then the next day on the 29th, me and my son are going to Philly to watch the we're going to watch the national championship game for Division I men's lacrosse. So that's going to be a good time.
That's cool. Awesome. Yeah.
But what else we got here? Got a Big D showdown, Will?
Yeah, there's the Big D showdown. It's a 48 person event, June 3rd and 4th in the DFW area. That's what Dallas Fort Worth. Yes. I imagine if you know DFW is, then you'll know where to go.
Yeah, the crew that puts on that is good folks. Some of them are, at least Legion wise, are the people that did the Dallas Open right after COVID and before COVID, and we went to that tournament and it was a piss ton of fun. So if you guys are anywhere near Dallas, you should definitely go.
Awesome.
Or you can go down to the Rocket City Championship Series in Huntsville, Alabama. Yes. They're having a bunch of events, June 3rd and September 23rd. Ben said he might try to go to that, but who knows at this point? He may be dead or alive or a doctor or not. We're not sure. And then there's the Ruckus at Rhodia in the Bayou Wars in Biloxi, Mississippi, right next to New Orleans. I'm going to do my darndest to be down there and try to go home for a couple days, as I'm from New Orleans.
Nice.
You got to do that. That seems
fun.
Seems a lot of fun.
Yeah. Cammy's done a bunch of promo cards for us, and she's putting on that tournament, and she is a sweetheart, and y'all should go support her event.
It's got Maximum Firepower at Atomic Empire in Durham, North Carolina. That's the 10th and 11th of June. That's 50 looking to get to 64 players.
Yeah,
that's a big one.
Will Heim, other Will is going. So, and it's really not that far for us. It's about 6 hours. So if you want to make a weekend of it, it's a great crew down there. Several STABcast, or I shouldn't say STABcast, Sunsphere Defense Fleet alumni.
Ooh.
Our old X-Wing
bringing out
group.
The old days.
Yeah, that's right. Cool. The before times.
I remember when it all started. Well, I don't, but you do.
I do, yeah. Then plowing into June, it is June is busy. We have the Atlantic City Open in, Atlantic City. The New Jersey crew is fantastic. The guys putting that on are fantastic individuals. I've been the last 2 years, sadly, with my new job and vacation restrictions, I'm not going to be able to go try to take my title back of top 8 from Kyle Chan. He knocked me out of top 8 last year. I beat him in the top 8 the year before. We are bitter, you know, rebel rivals as like the odd man in the top 8 that doesn't belong. But Atlantic City is always a good tournament. Weird venue, good tournament.
And I guess, boy howdy, I get all of Texas here. Lone Star Open.
Well, you are kind of from Colorado. So. That's kind of that direction.
Oh, don't. all the Texas folk, they're moving to Colorado because it's the place to be. So, but the Lone Star Open July tickets are live now. And that's, July 22nd to 23rd. That sounds like a good time, too.
Yeah. That's a B in very hot Texas.
Yeah. And then there's this little one called Gen Con, which apparently is two words, I've been told. Is Gen Con. Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Yeah. It is. Gen Con.
August 3rd through the 6th.
Have you guys ever been to Gen Con out of curiosity?
I have not, no.
My fiance and I, we went for the first time last year, and it was it was chaotic. So
yes, your first year always is. You slowly figure out how to Gen Con.
Yeah, we because
that's different for everybody.
Yeah, because we had gone to PAX Unplugged, and that was a great convention to just show up to. But if you're going to Gen Con, make a plan and stick to a plan and do that thing.
Yes, for sure. There's a food truck schedule spreadsheet for a reason.
Holy moly.
Yes. But yeah, that was a great time.
Yeah, Gen Con's probably my favorite convention of the year, so I will definitely be there. And the last tournament we have on this list, although we got to pare this down, is the Crucible, September 29th through October 1st in sunny Orlando. Now, that's a nice time to go to Orlando as it's starting to cool down, early October, late September. Jordan at Luminous Gaming is putting that event on. I will be down there as a judge, as a competitor, and I'll be running my doubles event on Sunday, so it is going to be a super fun weekend. They've got a few tickets, I think, left, the Crucible is going to be fantastic. And everybody can get to Orlando super cheap. Like, that's the nice thing. It's kind of like Vegas, where you can just, everybody can fly there for $100.
Right, yeah, it's good stuff. It's good stuff. Allegiant Air goes right down that way, I think, and some other places too.
Yeah.
If you want to fly that.
I mean, that is a choice of which you can make.
I'm cheap, dude.
I can't say anything. I took Spirit to New Jersey.
I'm going to Philly on airline miles, man, that I've accumulated from work travel. So that's I'm cheap.
Well, we got some news. Not much, but news. And it's all Rebel news, so I should be excited. Through the organized play article, we have the promo version of the Ewok Warriors or the Ewok Skirmishers, and they are interesting for 40 points.
Yeah.
They look like B1s on the face, six minis to a man, one wound, one courage, white save, no surging, but just a single black die melee attack. No range options. Is interesting. Priced at 40, so they're a little more than the old B1s, but they do have two super interesting keywords in low profile and unhindered.
Nice. Well, that low profile will help out with that white saves, just like my scouts for the Empire. So that's a big bonus when they're so squishy.
Yeah, getting these guys in though is going to be tough because the low profile is going to help.
Speed two. If they were speed three, you'd be right on top of them super fast. But
Then they'd be cocaine bear.
Cocaine bear, that's perfect.
Yeah, so they've got a heavy personnel and a training slot as well.
Is this the first core that we've seen with a training slot, like, baked in?
You got phase twos.
Oh, that's right. Yeah,
I think that's it, though, isn't it?
Okay. Probably. So. Yeah. Almost everybody else has access to one through some kind of upgrade.
Right.
But just baked on the unit card. So that's interesting. That's super interesting. I don't know what to put there. I really don't.
So here's the combo that I was thinking of, though, because we got the Chewy AT-ST as well, right?
Yeah, well, we'll get to there. Yeah. That one's zesty, and I'm sure Chad will have
blasphemy.
But so Chewie ATST has inconspicuous, right? Or incognito.
Incognito. Yeah. It's got the KTS.
And it's also a line of sight blocker.
Okay.
How many Ewoks can you hide behind an ATST? That's my question.
I don't like any of these thoughts.
So, do you think if we look up at the top left of the card? They do have a Rebel Alliance affiliation.
True.
So regular Rebels can take two to three of them, depending on if you took Underworld Connections or not. Is there a place, once again, we don't have the heavies, we don't have the personnel, we know that's probably where wonky Ewok rules are going to get introduced, or in those slots. But with what we see now, is there a place to take Ewoks in a regular Rebel army, not taking the Bright Tree Village?
You know, I don't know. I mean, melee skewed list maybe, but still, I'm not really sure. Because that's just not how I play. So I look at
sure.
It's a cool looking card, but beyond that, I can't think of anything to do with it.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I'm kind of at a bit of a loss. And I think a lot of it's going to come down to the price of the personnel and heavy slots and like what they happen to bring. But like on the face of it, maybe bring one just to try to like, as Luke charges in or Wookiees charge into something, somebody else to come behind and follow up and just tie them up and die slowly. I don't know. They're interesting. I'm not super excited.
Could be a
super
good
excited.
Speed bump. I mean, they could
be
a good
speed bump.
A nice little, you know, sort of a shield, maybe. I don't know.
And yeah, and we'll see what the other two, what upgrades, because we know we're getting a whole bunch of different types of Ewok troopers for those heavy and personnel slots.
Yeah, that's true.
I think that will add a lot to this, especially if they're, you know, B1 priced where, you know, extra models are just, you know, 6 or 7 points. But yeah, the star of the show, the Chewbacca, the aforementioned Chewbacca ATSD with Incognito. This thing is weird. This thing is really weird.
I'll tell you what the best part of it is, in my opinion, is General Weiss on the top.
Uh-huh.
Honestly, the rest of it's garbage, but that's a good part, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's cool that they're giving you the option if you want to buy another
ATSD. Yeah, it's pretty cool.
I'll be anxious to see if it's a different sculpt, or it's probably like not the... It's probably the new hard plastic, so I imagine the model's going to look a lot better than the Wave 1 release. It's cool that they're putting all the stuff in the package that whether you want to play Bright Tree Village or you want to play Empire, you can pick one of these bad boys up. But on the back of the card, we see Chewbacca. We already know what the Imperial ATSD does. There's no real surprises there. But we get Chewbacca, who is Bright Tree Village only. He is not Rebel Alliance affiliated.
Nice. Which I feel like is probably a good choice. I'm not sure.
I am sad.
I'm sure you are.
It's probably a good choice. It's probably for the health of the game a good choice.
Look, chickens all over the table.
How many points is it?
Through my zoom and enhance abilities,
excellent.
It is 190 points, it looks like.
Okay.
Which is pretty expensive. Some other weird things about it. We talked about how it's got, you know, it's got the Incognito, which is cool. It's got Arsenal, it's got armor just like you'd expect. It's got Inspire 3.
Huh, okay.
All right.
Why?
That's wild. I mean, Inspire, on a like the bigger base that you get, the better it is because it covers so much area. The other thing that strikes me is this the first time we've seen range 0 to like to melee 2 range weapons? Because it's got 3 weapons at the bottom, and its last 2 can be used in melee. As well as range 2 and range 3.
That's sketchy. I don't like that.
Is it?
That's super interesting.
I think there's something else on Din, maybe, that's similar. Versatile pistol and Grievous's pistol, right?
So. Yeah, we have versatile, but these aren't versatile because obviously like they don't.
Yeah, that's true.
Vehicles
that's true.
Don't get engaged, which is what versatile is useful for, to shoot out of an engagement. But yeah, that's so you can get base to base with something, or something can melee you and you can still, you know,
blast him.
It's not your best gun, but it's a decent little shot. He's 11 wounds. He breaks at 8. He surges on a white save. And he doesn't have any upgrades, so would you ever, Chad, as the Imperial player, would you ever consider running an ATST without any weapon
Absolutely
upgrades?
Not. No. Nope. I mean, if everybody's going to target one of your models, you
sure.
want it to be worth the hell and fire
worth
and brimstone
yeah.
that's going to be poured down upon it. You want to be able to do something with those points and all that attention. And if you can't add stuff to it, I wouldn't like it.
Does surge crit change that? Because Chewie does surge to crit.
It's pretty cool. I give you that. That is pretty cool. I wish that the other one did, obviously.
Sure.
But that
sure.
is a big thing.
And I think that's the kind of the trade-off, is the Empire is going to get some more versatility and just flat out more dice. But Chewie's probably going to force just about the same amount of saves with surge crit, especially if you can spool up some aim tokens. and you've got all the utility of Inspire and Incognito. It's interesting. I don't know that it's worth the cost premium at 190 points for a Rebel army. That's very expensive.
Yeah, I mean,
but it's an interesting piece. It's a definitely
for the Empire
piece.
To get Surge to hit, you got to spend an extra 10 points for the Hammer's Pilot, but you can't get Surge to crit. So,
and it's not even like, yeah, it's really good. And he's probably the default pilot, but there's also an opportunity cost because then you're not able to take Weiss, so you're not able to generate free aims.
Yeah.
So it's interesting. I was talking with, I think, Tim the other night. I don't know. I think there's, he came up with one, but I can't remember off the top of my head. Have we seen a unit with no upgrades before? That this is just what you get?
You know, I don't think so.
This is a weird release. I'm here for it. I want to say he came up with one, but off the top of my head, I cannot remember what
now
it
you
was.
Said this was Bright Tree only.
So
from what it looks like.
Theoretically, yes. I mean, obviously we don't know, but if you look at the card, there's the, all the mercenaries have their affiliation symbol, and there's the little bubbles of who else can take them. There are no bubbles.
There's something there, but it looks blacked out. So
yeah, so I'm assuming he will only be able to go in mercenary battle forces that have him listed, and we are at right now, we are assuming that is only going to be Bright Tree Village. So,
well, they've got to have some sort of vehicle. Everybody's got some sort of vehicle that they can use. So I guess that's the one. I mean, I think it would have been. I mean, personally, Empire player, I think it'd have been cooler if they had, you know, one of their flying machines or something like that, maybe. But
yeah, and I think in time we'll get to see that. I would love to play some Ewok gliders.
That's what I'm saying. I think that would have been cool, and maybe it's because, again, I'm strictly an Empire player, but I think that this might be, I mean, I understand the somatics or the cinematography aspect of it, you know, but I'm like, it's kind of cheating. It's an easy thing. You're just copying a model and sticking Chewie in it versus instead of creating a whole new model that's more applicable.
It's pretty different, though.
Yeah.
I feel like it'll play very different than the AT-ST, because this thing you're going to, like kind of Will alluded to a while ago with the Ewoks, you're going to use it as a shield to run your army of worthless bears up.
That's true.
And get to range 2 and then start blasting folk instead of being this range 4 like assault cannon.
And that could have been why they did this too, so that it could make the Ewok troopers more viable. Maybe the idea behind it.
All I'm saying is I hope, and I can only imagine she will be, if Leia is in the Bright Tree Village Battle Force, and I can play Brains and Brawn.
Yes, that is the combo.
That'd be cool.
Oh man, that would be impressive.
Nice.
It's a one trick pony, but it's a hell of a trick.
But I do like the pilot options for the top of it. I think that's really cool. I wish the old one, the just Imperial one, had options to do that. And I know I've seen people that like kit bashed it before, but I just think that would be cool because it's just a neat option to make the model look different.
I really need, you know, we have the Imperial guy pointing, then we have like Chewbacca with his arms raised in his air. I need to get like a General Veers mini or something and put him in Chewbacca's hands.
He's just throwing him out, yeah.
Throwing out the window.
That's cool.
That would be perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah, cool stuff. We'll be late to the party as we always are at STABcast. As soon as we record an episode, in the interval of time from when we record to publish, there will probably be new news. I know there's a looming points update, and we'll touch on that here in a minute. But yeah, other than Ewoks and a Wookiee, slow news week. But what is fast upon us?
No, yes, I start to say that's good because we've got Rocky Top coming up.
Yeah,
we've got Rocky Top coming up. You know, I'm excited to have this thing off my plate. I'm scrambling to put tables together. We're getting our prize support in. It's super exciting. It's one of my favorite conventions every year, and I just get to walk around and yell at people.
Yeah, how is how's the tables coming along?
Right now I think we're pretty much there with what we have.
Okay.
I'm hoping some more people will submit more tables because I would love to show off. My goal is to show off community tables and use ours that people have been playing on who have come to sci-fi tournaments for years kind of as backups. Mm-hmm. And as people travel, because we've got people coming from all different states. I think we had 13 different states last year. I want people to bring the best tables from their communities. We're having a whole competition for it. to show off what they're doing. But you guys are competitors. You guys actually have to think about these things. How's your prep going? How do you guys prep for these big events? As someone who doesn't hit one, you know, what? 3-4 times a year.
Well, as I've alluded to several times before, I learned mm-hmm. from my last bigger tournament failure that just to practice. You know, I've gone away. I mean, you guys have played me a bunch, and I tend to play it a certain way, and I've tried to find something that feels comfortable for me that I can really sink my teeth into and do some strategizing around it, because I try not to depend on the dice, because I mean, it's random, right? So I try to build tactics around it that can benefit me in the way that I think. And as of right now, I found something in this list, and I'm just sticking with it and trying to get as many reps as possible with it. And that's kind of how I prep, and playing different people. I want to try to, in our community, luckily we've got several different players, so I can play different people.
Yeah. And yeah, we got a lot of variety.
So that helps. And we're kind of helping each other do that. Like I'm playing Nathan on Wednesday. He asked, and he mm-hmm. was like, I need practice with double darks. So I'm like, okay, I need practice with a guy of your caliber, because Nathan's just really good.
Yeah.
And
he's a monster. Yeah.
I mean, he'll just show up and just with something crazy and just slaughter you. So that's kind of how I do that. Plus kind of, it's funny. Like when I take a break or at work or whatever, I think about, okay, what if I did this and did this and try to get a flow, you know, because when I first started playing, yeah. I had very limited experience with Warhammer, and my mindset was kill everything and don't worry about anything else. Well, that doesn't work out so well in Legion.
Yeah, I mean, it can, but
it usually does. I have one list that the whole idea is to just kill, because I don't have many thumbs and I can't grab anything. In this aspect, that's what I'm trying to do, is think about and actually have a game plan. I tend to be more reactive, and I don't need to be. I need to be a little more proactive. So that's kind of some things that I've been trying to do in preparation for the next, you know, larger tournament with some heavier competition like this one.
Sure. What about you, Will?
So, unlike Chad, who learned from his failure at Cherokee, I am reacting to my hubris of my relative success at Cherokee. And instead of dialing in and practicing a specific list for Rocky Top, I have been waffling super duper hard, playing lists that I have no intention of playing, and I don't expect it to go well for me.
That's all right. We built the list you're going to play on the road right
home.
That's true. From Nashville. So we just haven't brought it out yet to scare the people. It's secret tech.
Exactly. That's right.
It's so bad.
The think tank.
It's neat, but it's bad.
But one of the things that's, because I, for the most part, the archetypes that I do play, I've kind of got how I want to play them down, and they just need more reps. But what does really help me when preparing for big events and stuff is to take a look at the archetypes I'm going to be facing. Because I've found, huge. the biggest leap forward in my success, my win rate, has been when I know what my opponent is. Chad, you talked about it earlier. What is your opponent capable of? And mm-hmm. going through, you know, their command cards, so that when they play one, you don't have to read it and find out what they've just done to you. You know what I mean? Like,
right.
Yeah.
That's huge. And so that's, I'm looking at what, and if we get a points update right before Rocky Top, it's going to be awful.
You know, and that's something about, not to interrupt you, but that's something else I've been thinking about, is because right now I play double dark, and I swear I hate playing.
Oh, I hate it. Your list is going up 40 points.
Well, but and that's the point. What I've been thinking about is if it drops before Rocky Top, okay, what am I going to do? And I've been thinking about that.
Yeah.
And just theorizing. Well, like I'm gonna drop a dark and pick up some other things. And if I'm able to fit that all together, how does that change my strategy? How does that change how I set my models up tactically? And Will knows, he laughs at me. He gets a kick out of it. I come from a tactical background, so I lay my guys out in certain ways and things like that. So I'm like, what can I do if this happens to me? Because right now I love my list, so it's probably going to go up like 312 points.
So do you have a contingency plan? Because I think it's, obviously we're not oracles here, But I think we all have a pretty good idea of, at least in Empire, what's going to get hit in a points update versus what isn't. Do you have some contingency plans about, like, if darks go up?
Yes, I have thought about that. And, you know, and my dark units, both of them, they're very expensive because I'm running both. I'm running mm-hmm. both heavies. And I think if I can retain one of them and drop one of them, then maybe I can pick up another one of my Death Trooper units that I like so much, or maybe okay. you know, something else, another scout, something that I could do a little bit more with and try to supplement what capability I just lost because sure. of the points.
Yeah, because I think it's probably safe to say Death Troopers probably are not going up. Although HH-12s, they might, just because of the cumbersome change. Like, they got a buff through the cumbersome mm-hmm. change, and 17 points for an impact 3 weapon, even though it doesn't cycle, is pretty yes. solid. And on the concept of points change, Will, with what you just described, does that help you? If everybody's fighting in the dark, a points update right before the event is someone who list bounces a lot, who doesn't have all of the, you know, your list memorized to a T of what you're doing in, you know, turns 1 through 6 on each matchup. Like me and Chad tend to game out before these events. Does that help you if everybody's, you know, slinging mud with lists they haven't had but 2 days to practice?
Yeah, it's tough. I think it's probably net neutral because okay. they're probably playing something that they're less familiar or comfortable with. But it also is something that I'm not necessarily going to expect, right? You know, if sure. things shift and suddenly the shoreline is back. And I have to deal with that. Like, I don't know. I think it's probably overall just a net neutral. So
okay. Well, and I think, you know, you will come out ahead also because you play Republic and Rebels, the two factions that probably need more help than anybody else right now.
It's tough. I mean, outside of Anakin and maybe some Yoda lists, like, Republic's doing okay, I feel like.
Okay,
Just by nature of Red Saves, but yeah, Rebels are in a tough place.
Yeah.
As you know.
What are you guys doing other than, like, we've talked a lot about army construction and points. Are you guys doing anything else to prep other than just, like, show up on Wednesday night and play your army? Anything else to get ready for Rocky Top?
I sometimes on the weekends I'll watch some YouTube videos, battle reports, people playing, just to kind of see, to gain a little bit of that intel of what other armies can do. Because honestly, I try to tout that I pay a lot of attention to that, and I really try to, but I tend to be a little bit more reactive. I tend to be like, I know my sure. capabilities, and then when I see what's on the other side of the table, I try to figure out, okay, what adjustments do I need to make in order to do my game plan the way I want to do my game plan. And watching some other people play and seeing different people's tendencies is helpful. But I don't know, maybe I don't dig deep enough in it. But that's okay. just kind of what I'm doing there. That and making sure I got a water bottle in my bag.
Dude, a go bag, like the proper Legion yes. go bag for the ulcer events is crucial.
Yeah, absolutely.
What about you, Will? You doing anything?
Not specifically for Rocky Top, but lately one thing I kind of have enjoyed doing is to take a battle deck. Usually the one that I built for whatever list I'm using, and do a flop and you know, say, take that first row that pops out and say, okay, so if it's Battle Lines, Moisture Vaporators, and War Weary, what is my path to victory? You know,
sure.
I'm just kind of walk through those to make sure that whatever I am currently playing, I know, like, what I need to stay focused on and what is the best chance for me to win, right? So
that is a callback. We haven't done it in so long. But longtime Stabcast listeners will remember we did a segment called Red Player Dilemma,
nice.
Where we would pick, like, a list and, like, the worst objective setup that they could have possibly fallen themselves into and try to find a path to pilot out of.
Yeah, you guys should do that.
Yeah, that's a good one. Another thing is, like, looking at different tables. And that's why I've been. That's why I built that beach / scarif table.
That table's looking really good.
Is so that it would look different than what we're accustomed to playing with down there. You know, I've got sand dunes,
sure,
and
okay, yeah,
like
yeah,
that. And adding a little bit of difficult to pass through terrain, which we haven't necessarily yep. had a whole lot of, at least down where we normally play, and trying for to sure. figure that kind of stuff out and playing on different tables. Like, I bring mine because one of my two, either my Tatooine style table with the billboard and stuff, or this mm-hmm. Scarif one, because we have so many people playing, that takes up some of our terrain from down there. But I also like
yeah.
doing different things, like playing Mitch on the cardboard table. Because I'm hoping you're going to get it for Rocky Top, because I think people will love it.
It is going to be a Rocky.
It's so unique, and you will have to play differently on that table, because it doesn't look like it at first, but there's a lot of LOS blocking in
there's
that.
A lot going on
and
the
it's
table.
It
yeah.
is it's really cool. It turns a big table into a close quarter battle situation before you know it. You didn't even mm-hmm. know that you're right on top of each other, and it's really unique, and I like it a lot,
which I think is absolutely hilarious. As someone who I have built a grand total of one table in my time, and looking at the way Mitch likes to play, and it makes sense that he plays like these squirrely rebels and Han and Pistol Cassian and Sabine and Din, that he has all these line of sight blockers that he can interact with and hide behind, because it's a table that would be very fun for a lot of the armies he likes to play. And then we get to Chad's Beach, which has a far less line of sight blockers, but lots of patches of cover and area terrain and things to use in ways that in a way tend to reward the way Chad yeah. likes to play. And I love looking at people's tables and how they put their place. And I've done the same thing with my trench table. We put ways that we like to play like into different avenues of the game, which I think is super cool to see, especially when you know the players and you know how they like to play. You're like, oh, I see why you built that thing. I see, Ryan, why you built a giant height 2 rock to put in the middle of your crate table.
Well, and I think that's neat. The way that you are doing Rocky Top is you're getting people to submit tables and bringing all those difference in mm-hmm. versus like some other tournaments I've been to where you know about every other table looks the same, you know, which yeah, there yeah. there is an aspect of that that's good, but I like the random of all of these different folks, you know. I mean, how many tables sure. are you gonna have there?
We're gonna have 32.
Probably gonna have maybe, I don't know, 15, 20 different people that design these tables. Mm-hmm. And I think that adds a variable that can make the whole tournament more interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. It's gonna be super cool. So we barring point changes, we more or less know what Chad's playing. We have no idea what Will's playing. What do you guys think we're going to see a lot of? Is it all going to be Dark Troopers and Blizzard Force as far as the eye can see?
It's tough because I feel like people are starting to get over Dark Troopers. But people also like to win, you know. So I think you'll probably get the 60% Empire, and maybe a little more of that will be Blizzard Force and variations on Double Dark, Double Bounty probably.
Okay.
Yeah, I'd say you'll see a lot of bounty, and I think there'll be a fair share of darts. I mean, this is coming from a guy who's gonna bring some, and but I did it, and I'll preach my preach here. I am an Empire player. That's all I play. I have the freaking tattoo.
He played them when they were bad. He gets the
pass. I've got an Imperial emblem tattoo on my bicep. I am an Imperial guy.
Yeah.
But this remnant list plays to the way I want to play. That's why I play it.
It does. It absolutely
I didn't
does.
Know going in if it was going to be any good or not. I'd only played against Dark Troopers one time, but
sure.
it works for me. And that's I still go to the rule of cool a little bit, and to me it's cool because it works for me. And that's,
well, I remember when it was first, the Remnant was first put out and we got the rules for it, and Chad was a good boy and avoided Blizzard Force. Never
nope.
played it. Vader
never
was
played
not
it.
Typically
nope.
your style.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And you were like, oh, all these cool kids are just going to switch to Remnant. I'm not going to yeah. play Remnant. I'm going to play this other thing. And I remember we had several conversations like, Chad, you're going to play Remnant.
Well, it was kind of tailor-made to the way
it's
I play.
Really
so.
Yeah,
yeah, exactly. Yeah, for sure.
But I think, I don't know if you'll see much Remnant because I've just been looking around. I think you'll see Darks with other Imperials. You know, and maybe you see some Palp show up, like what Will was talking about.
Maybe.
Yeah,
oh, yeah, that's, I mean, that's oh, a God. That's a spooky I actually think we'll see less Empire, not less than we have, not less than any other faction. I think it'll probably still be the most represented. But I think Will kind of touched on it. People are getting a little tired of it. We're gonna have two undefeated, so we're not gonna have a clear cut winner, and there's no Worlds invites on the line.
Yeah, that's a big key.
I think if you have a list that you really like to play and you want to prove something with, this is the perfect place to bring it, because there's not a ton. Like, I'm a promo guy. Like, most of my prize support money has gone into participation prizes and stuff for everyone to get. So I think that, I know we have at least two or three people that are vying to be the best Fluttercraft or best Grogu player. So,
and that'll be cool. I mean, that'll be neat. And I think that aspect of it, I mean, not that I would make it that far, but I'm kind of glad there's not a world's invite on this one, because it can just be, I like the variety of it, you know, whereas you could, being an Empire player, I'm, you know, everywhere else I'm betting, like, you know, if I'm going to get five games, it's probably going to be four mirror games, you know? I'll do it and it's fun and all, and I like it, but I prefer like the variety of the game. And I think maybe you're going to get a little bit of that out of this.
Yeah, it's an exciting time. This can't be right.
What can't be right?
My time code says 1 hour and 15 minutes.
That's great.
This is weird. STABcast episodes are supposed to be 2 hours, and I'm at the end of the document. This is strange.
Oh, buddy.
My show runs about like a Catholic mass. It's an hour. I mean, I'm Catholic, so I can say that. So it's an hour and we're out the door. You know what I mean? So I'm used to keeping things rolling. You know what I mean?
But I think we've about covered it, and Ben's not here to talk about Gungans, so
we can talk about always, Gungans.
I mean, do you have anything thoughts you wanna make? Are Gungans gonna be the Dark Trooper counter with their little Goomba balls?
Oh, buddy, I hope so. That's the real hero we need is Gungans right now. Please.
Will hates my Dark Troopers so bad.
No, I everyone hates your Dark Troopers, Chad.
We have so much hate, discontent. Jeez.
So until next time, guys, thanks for spending your drive time, your paint time, whatever it is, the hell time you bother to listen to this nonsense. Until next time, I'm Ryan Slowoski, reminding you that you should probably come to Rocky Top. We'll probably have walk-ons. Who knows? I don't know. We'll see you there.
And I'm Will Werner, reminding you to pick up Ahsoka Tano this week.
And I'm Chad Riggs, reminding you that the Geonosians cometh.
Ooh, are they gonna cause you to switch factions?
Not
you buy a
chance.
A little Geonosian battle force?
Not a chance now. Long live the Empire.
They kind of worked for the Empire.
Purist. Long live the Empire.
That's called racist.
No. We got Thrawn. No. We got Thrawn, and he's the best.
And we set it on the internet forever. Yeah, speciesist. There you go. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
It's nice to have people on the show that agree that Rebels are in a bad spot.
Yeah, that's actually why you brought us on, right?
That's so we can agree with you. That's my whole plan. That's my whole plan.